Hi, welcome back to my channel. I'm Bianca, one of the bosses, and today I have something special planned. So a few years ago, I did a video about a reading plan on YouVersion, which was called 7 Ways to Thrive Before 45, and it was a three-part video and it got the most views that any of my videos have ever gotten. And it was really something that I wanted to share, and I felt like I needed to share that. But then I was pregnant at that time, or I just found out I was pregnant afterward or something. I think I was pregnant. Anywho, so pregnancy just hit me hard and I never finished the second and the third part of that video. So today, 3, 2, 1, or 2 years later, I'm gonna continue with that and finish it for you guys. And I really, really believe that it's something that is of good value, and I hope you enjoy it. So here is 7 Ways to Thrive Before 45, Part 2. Before we start, I would like to say thank you for watching my videos, and please remember to like and subscribe and click the notification bell to catch our videos as we upload every Saturday. So let's get started. So I'm gonna do the same trend that I followed in the first video, and we're gonna start off with prayer. I'm gonna tell you, read to you, or explain what I got from the reading plan, and you're welcome to go and follow the reading plan along. It is on YouVersion Bible app, which is free from Google Play Store, and I'm just gonna put the scriptures on the screen and you can pause at any time to read through them, just to save some time and not me reading to you all the time. So you're welcome to close your eyes. You're welcome to keep it open. We're going to start off with prayer. God, I just want to really come and I want to ask that you will just speak through me today. And God, I just want to really come and ask that you would speak through me today, and that you would sow into the lives of this viewer who's watching right now, and really just speak through them and open up their minds and hearts in the way that you want it to, and to make an impact in the way that you want to make an impact today, God. And I truly thank you for this opportunity to just share your heart and your will. And thank you for the person that wrote this beautiful plan. May you bless her and just guide her to deliver more, and just open up more people's hearts for you, God. And I truly pray that whoever's watching right now, that you will just come and change them in a way that you would like to, and just bless their life in a beautiful manner, God. Amen. Okay, so let's get started. I'm taking forever. I'm sitting very close to you because of the lighting situation going on today. The weather is kind of weird and we have a lot of shadows. So that's where we're at. So number one for today, which is activity number 8. So please make sure that you click and watch my previous part 1 to get the first 7. So today we're starting off with number 8, which is to disciple someone. So as we grow closer to God and mature, if we could say it like that, in our Christianity, it's so healthy for you to mentor someone else in their spiritual walk with God. So basically, when I'm looking down, I'm looking at my notes, I want you to be available for when God sends someone to your path. Be honest about your struggles, about your successes. Just really be honest to that person about your opinion in a very healthy way. Be healthy yourself. Be an example. That's so important, to be an example if you mean to someone. And then be a listener. Be open to listening before you just comment, because when we listen, we get quiet and we really pay attention to hear what's not being said. And we also get quiet so that we can listen to what the Holy Spirit wants to say through us. So really try to be a listener too, and be prayerful. Really pray for the person, pray for their relationship with God, and pray for your relationship with them as well as your relationship with God. So be a prayerful person when you want to mentor someone. So I also took note that when you mentor someone, you are not responsible for them. Like, I really want you to get, you are not responsible for them and their relationship with God. You're just a teacher, an example, someone that they can come to, like a psychologist almost. So you're not responsible for that woman's faith, for that woman's growth, or her mistakes, or who she is responsible for that, okay? But I really want you to also remember, when you mentor someone, you should mentor from a very healthy, emotional, spiritual place. It's not good if you mentor someone and you're not feeling it, or you're not ready and your relationship with God is lacking. It's always good to be honest and say, hey, I just need a break. For a week or two, I need to get back on track with my relationship with God. It's healthy for that person to also know life goes up and down. Our faith sometimes go up and down because we're not God, we're not Jesus, but we try and we grow. So really mentor from a healthy spiritual and emotional place when you mentor. So some scriptures that you could read, I'm just going to pop them up on the screen, like I said, and you can pause at any time. So the first is Titus 2 verse 3 to 5. Secondly, Psalms 71 verse 18 and Matthew 28 verse 19. Okay, number 9 is we need to take care of our body. And when I did this plan, it clicked, but it didn't click as much as it clicks now, because back then I was not in a good place physically with my body. But now I'm so strong and I'm confident and I'm feeling good because of a mindset change. Okay, so why do we need to take care of our body? So first off, from this reading plan, our heart, our soul, and our mind, they're all housed in our body. So it's all connected. And one will influence the other. Then it can all grow or it can all rot. And we obviously don't want to do that. We don't want to go down that path. So physical health. What is physical health? And according to our reading plan, physical health is equal parts self-control, healthy self-esteem, and stewardship of the body God gave you. So a healthy self-esteem, really try to love yourself, be happy with who you are, have self-control in things like indulgence or I feel like body, a physical healthy body could go either way. You could over exercise or over lazy lying on the couch. You could overeat or you could over starve. So really just having self-control and having a balance over your body and your life. And then really just taking stewardship, really taking care of the body that God gave you. It's not about looking a certain way. It's about feeling happy, being healthy, and, you know, just loving yourself. That I think it's really good. So thinking about what you put into your body, thinking about what you use your body for, thinking about how you show your body, it's all things that you can use to serve and worship God with the body He gave you. So obviously, first off, you need to accept that God really, really loves you unconditionally, no matter how you look, no matter how you feel, no matter how healthy you are, God will still love you. It's about gifting God, or giving a gift of stewardship, giving a gift of, I'm going to take care of this temple that you gave me. I really want to look after it and make it an object to worship God. So I really... You should really, really make your motivation to live healthy, free of any shame or guilt. That is not what we're doing here. You shouldn't feel shameful about how you are or how you feel or look. You shouldn't feel guilty about it. It's about you wanting to serve God in a certain manner. It should really come from a place rooted in love and freedom in Jesus. So some Bible verses that you could read here is John 1 verse 2, Colossians 3 verse 17. Okay, so number 10 is quite a controversial one, which is pay off debt. We all know debt is not a good thing. It does not make you feel good. It does not... look good for your future if you have a lot of debt, but in today's modern life, it's such an easy thing to just swipe the credit card or get an account and pay it off later with interest. We forget that part, but really paying off debt is something you should do or try to do so that you can thrive before 45. So in Romans 13 verse 7 to 8, it's talking about we need to pay off what we owe and make our only debt loving each other. Isn't that beautiful? What if that is how every person lives on earth? What a beautiful place it would be, just loving each other, seeing that like, I'm going to serve you and I'm going to pay you by loving you. That's so beautiful. And it all comes down to really living simply and giving lavishly. Living simply yourself and giving lavishly, which I could talk on forever and ever, but that's not the point of today. So it's really important that we walk in self-control, that we honor God and have integrity. And those three things is really going to help you when you need to pay off debt. It's going to help you stay debt-free if you can. So this is something that Dave Ramsey talks a lot about, and you can definitely check out his baby steps, which number two is definitely paying off debt. But it's just such a biblical thing to have no debt, not live in debt. It's actually in the Bible. It mentions something about you shouldn't ever be a guarantor or have a guarantor or something like that. Please don't quote me. I don't know the verse out of my head. But I know that God does not want us to live a life full of debt and stress and guilt. Number 11, develop a rhythm of prayer. Okay, so first of all, we need to remember that you have unlimited access to the throne room. Unlimited. You have direct access. The Wi-Fi connection is never bad. My baby is awake and she should really not be. Your Wi-Fi connection is never bad, and there's just, you always have access. You can go anytime, speak anytime, direct access. There are literally on the, no matter who's teaching you what, there are absolutely no rules to prayer. There's so many people who say you should pray a certain way, but Jesus taught us that simple is sometimes best. And praying out of your heart, having faith, is best. So there are no rules to prayer, only you will, however, find some practices and guidelines to help you connect in prayer if that's something that you might need help with. In this plan, it spoke about firstly having gratitude. Now, having gratitude, she mentioned the verse about 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 16 to 19, which is all about rejoicing. And then Philippians 4, verse 6 to 7, which just says, again, rejoice. Then the second thing is having praise, just praising God for how wonderful and amazing and awesome and mighty He is. And then confessing, be honest about your sin and doubts and fears, and really just confess about all of those things. And then you can read 1 John 1 verse 9. And then intercede, like really connect with God in your prayer. And supplication. When we, you basically ask for His will and His ways, because God says His plans is better than we can ever imagine. His will for you is amazing. So really trusting in that and having faith in God knows what's best, and God has a plan, and you might not understand that plan, but it's dang well going to be much better than your plan. So just really, these are just some guidelines to use when you pray. So having gratitude, giving praise, confessing, interceding, praying for other people, and supplication, like giving, laying down your will and your desires and asking God for His will and His desires to take place. So really just developing a healthy rhythm of prayer. Sometimes I'd like to pray very long during driving or at night. Other times I would just walk around the day and talk to God, because having the specific rhythm of prayer is really, really helpful to keep on praying. So that's the whole end goal, be all right, just to keep on praying and keeping that connection and growing your relationship with God. Number 12 is to be generous. Now, be generous comes again back to not, you can be generous when you live simply, you know, live simply, give lavishly. So be generous, but you can be generous in your time, in your love, in your obviously money, but even in your service and in giving stuff away, or it doesn't always have to be a physical materialistic thing. You can be generous in the way you love, in the way you talk, in the way you enjoy in your time. So there's a lot of things where we could be generous. And two verses that you could read is Romans 12, verse 5 to 8, Luke 6, verse 38. Number 13 is being content. So we all hope to be content with ourselves and with life when we are 45, you know? So being content is something that we all hope for and dream for. But you can actually start being content with where you are in life right now, in what stage you are, just accepting the stage of life and really appreciating the space of the life where you are now, even if it's going bad, because when it's going good, you need to appreciate the bad, because now you can identify that it's going good. So really just being content in yourself. So I wrote down, a fickle heart lusts after what it can't have. Contentment ignores the murmurs of pride. And we know we need to be humble, so. So it's literally being content is all about your perspective, right? So you really want to work. We're all working towards something better and desiring better things and good things in life, but it's about your perspective while you are working toward those good or better things. So it was put so beautifully when it says, if we chase after what we want with discontent in our belly, we miss out in finding Christ to be enough in our days and months. And we don't want to miss out in finding Christ to be enough. We want Christ to be enough. So really, it's all about changing your perspective and the way you think and having a mindset change. So when we are content, we are definitely going to be more grateful and more thankful for our everyday lives and what happens in our everyday lives, right? And then when you are content, you're boldly proclaiming that Jesus is your helper, Jesus is your deliverer, and Jesus is your restorer. And you're loudly proclaiming that you believe in that. You could go and read Philippians 4, verse 12 to 13, and 1 Timothy 6, verse 6 to 7, which is just a verse that I really don't like to hear. It says, nothing goes with you to heaven. Don't stir up things that don't go with you to heaven. And I don't like to hear that, but we sometimes just need to. Okay, so I really hope that you made it thus far. And if you did, thank you very much. Please remember to like and subscribe. And let's move on to number 14. So number 14 is ditching negative self-talk. And if you're a mom, I really hope you do this. Because from where I am in life, I've really done that. Moms are terrible at this, and it's something that you really need to concentrate on. So ditching negative self-talk. Even as a teenager, I remember that this was something I had to focus on. So I'm guessing every stage of a woman's life, you need to focus on this. So don't talk negatively about yourself, okay? So literally, you need to remember that God handcrafted us. He handcrafted us. So when we talk negatively about ourselves, we are disrespecting the woman that God handcrafted us to be. Like, we're disrespecting that. We really constantly need to remember that we are His masterpiece. You are His masterpiece, and He made you specially. He wonderfully just knit you together exactly like you planned. We need to respect that. We need to love that. So it doesn't really matter how bad you are at something, how bad you are at housework, how bad you are at your work, how bad you are in your physical life, in whatever, whether you can have a baby or whether you cannot have a baby if you're struggling, whether you want a baby or not. Literally, it doesn't matter how bad you think you are and how bad you think you are at something. Nothing, but literally nothing, invites you to talk negatively about yourself. Nothing. Something else that I also took from this plan was your negative self-talk stings those around you more than we think. We're only talking to ourselves, but we sting the people around you. You shoot down compliments. People compliment you. And they really, whenever someone tells you you look pretty and you're like, oh, no, it's nothing. But it's not nothing. You made an effort. Take it. If they say something like, wow, you're such a good housekeeper or such a good cook, don't say it's nothing. Don't say, oh, I just followed a recipe. No, take it. Stop shooting people's compliments down. It's literally like a slap in the face if you give someone a compliment and they don't want to accept it or they don't want to believe you. They're like, you're a liar. That's not nice to hear. So really believing and taking in those compliments. You need to remember that when people compliment us, they're acknowledging you, how you look, or the effort that you put into something, or just the beautiful person you are, your amazing personality, and they're actually making an effort to point it out and acknowledge that. So they're really blessing you, and we should stop pushing the blessings that others give us away. You can go and read Proverbs 4 verse 23, Philippians 4 verse 8 and 9, Psalms 139 verse 13. And that was the second seven things, ways to thrive before 45. Again, thanks for watching my video. I promise that I will do part three soon this time. Make sure to click the subscribe button, the notification bell, so that you can get notified whenever I upload. On Saturdays, we do videos about marriage, about motherhood, and about Christianity and just cozy living. So thank you again for watching, and I really hope that God spoke to you today in some way and that you could improve and thrive by 45. Thanks for watching. Bye.